Hey everybody, it's Aldo Gandhi, and I just want to let you know really quickly that our swag shop is reopened. DeepDishTees.com is where you go, and that's Tees with T-E-E-S. Clever name, guys. They're the new home of our merchandise. You can get t-shirts, you can get caps, you can get coffee mugs, you can get hoodies, you can get all sorts of good stuff, and you'll help out the bar room with the purchase. So head over to DeepDishTees.com.
What's up and welcome back to Bar Down Blackhawk Talk, episode number 20, presented by the Barroom Network. My name is Vinnie Parisi, and I'm here with Joey Parisi and Joseph. This weather stinks.
I know. Tell me about it, right? It's like, can't even do shit. And then that feeling, this, especially this morning, like, you don't even want to get out of bed.
I didn't for like an hour. Yeah. Not even. I posted all my articles to Twitter, got all a bunch of tweets fired, and I did not move.
Yeah, I mean, there was one day, like, it was actually a couple days ago, you know, long weekend of some drinking. I think I stayed in bed until, like, 12:30 and just did not get out of bed. I sound like a lazy fuck, but, like, sometimes you just need those days where you just don't fucking move.
Yeah, you are a lazy fuck. Everybody knows that. It's just, like, so hot. Like, I'd rather it be 30. I really would. Like, my favorite weather is, like, 65, 70, like, crisp, not too hot, not too cold. But if I'm taking 100 with a heat index that's incredibly high versus, you know, the nasty cold, I'm taking the nasty cold. It's not even close.
Yeah, the thing that, you know, really pisses me off is not necessarily the heat, but the humidity. I'm a big AC guy. I'm in the car. I blast my AC. And then when I get out of the car and my sunglasses, my phone, the camera, it just all fogs up instantly. And it's the worst thing in the world. I hate it.
You know my least favorite part about it being this hot, too? I can't enjoy one of my favorite foods. I love soup.
No, see.
And I want to know your opinion on soup. You're going to skip some stupid opinion about soup. Go right
No, ahead. I love soup. Soup is top-tier food. I hate that fucking stigma that you can't have soup when it's hot out. You can't
have ice. I still have it.
You can't have ice cream when it's negative 2 degrees outside. Fuck that. Eat that shit whenever you want.
Yeah. Like, sometimes you don't want like the hottest of hot foods when it's 1,000 degrees outside.
Are you eating it outside? What are we? You're eating it inside where it's 70 degrees no matter what, whether it's winter.
There's a mood. There's a mood when it comes to your cuisine.
I don't believe in that.
What's your Mount Rushmore of soups?
Clam chowder. Okay. Undisputedly number one. And then the other three in no particular order. Broccoli cheddar. What's another like chowdery one? What's the one with rice?
Oh, chicken and rice, like chicken
yeah,
and rice.
Like a chowdery rice soup, whatever it may be. And then probably something a little brothy. I'll just go your classic chicken noodle, but it's gotta have some good noodles. Don't give me that fucking Campbell's like just dissolve in your mouth noodle shit.
Bland chicken noodle soup is the worst. Good chicken noodle soup is very good. That's tough for me. We both nailed New England clam chowder, like the white clam chowder. That's number one. And number two is a good French onion. Love French onion. You're a clown. You know, French onion at its best could be number one.
Feel free to comment your favorite soups in the chat. We got a great
soup. Let me hear your favorite soup. I want to hear your opinion on soup if you're watching. Number three, any type of like beer cheddar soup is delicious.
Yeah.
I would go with that. And then, of course, bisque. Lobster bisque, my favorite, like right up there. Those are the top four for me.
Lobster bisque is good, but a bad lobster bisque like can really fuck up a lobster bisque for me.
Yeah. Well, a bad anything with fish could be like gross.
Yeah, I've had some like clam chowders that people consider bad, but like I still fucking love it.
Yeah. Well, for those who don't know, before I got into this whole sports industry that I'm in now, I actually worked at Panera Bread for 8 years and had my fair share of soup while working there, grinding away, trying to get to where I am now. So eat soup. And according to Joey, no matter what the temperature is outside, eat soup.
Mm-hmm.
So now that our soup discussion's over, period number one. It's a sad time in the hockey world. We lost a legend. And we're going to try and bring light to this legend in a dark time. You know, if anybody's watching that enjoyed Tony Esposito throughout his NHL career. Before we get going on his career, I do think there is one little clip that I would like to share that kind of embodies what he was as a human being. Take a listen.
To be in the Hall of Fame was something great. But there are hundreds of players that are in the Hall of Fame. But to have your sweater retired in this fashion, and there's only a handful, is the ultimate dream that I could ever have wanted. And with the wonderful people of Chicago, thank you very much.
Yeah, Tony Esposito, one of the league's all-time greatest goalies. He died of it was a short battle with cancer at 78 years old. And, you know, this guy was a beast, man. I could go over his career achievements now, or would you like to say something about him before I do that?
Yeah, you know, the hockey world definitely lost a legend. He was a pioneer to the game, especially for the goaltending position. You know, he ended up playing 873 games in the crease, and that's something that just is not really done today. That's remarkable. He's a legend. He deserves all, you know, his Hall of Fame nod and that number to never be worn in the history of Chicago ever again, and it's rightfully deserved. And rest in peace to the legendary goalie Tony Esposito.
Yeah. Great words. Tony Esposito, he's a Chicago great, I would say, in terms of the entire sports landscape, not just hockey. But some statistics on him. He's a 5-time All-Star, which making the All-Star in the NHL back then, even now, it's an honor. It's a great privilege. It means you're amongst the best.
Even harder for goaltenders.
Exactly, because, you know, there are less of them as opposed to skaters. But he was the recipient of the Calder Trophy in his rookie season. And, of course, he had 15 shutouts that season, which earned him the nickname Tony O. For those, you know, it's a pretty fairly well-known thing. But the Calder Trophy is a big deal in the NHL. It was back then. It is now. You win the Calder Trophy. That means people believe that you're going to go on to have a very nice career. And sure enough, he did. The Vezina Trophy was awarded to him 3 times. As you know, the Blackhawks haven't had too many Vezina Trophy winners. They just acquired one in a trade, and everyone's making a big deal about it. That just goes to show how important that trophy is to hockey fans and hockey people. I'm crazy about the Vezina Trophy. I think it's probably the most impressive award you can win in the NHL. And, you know, winning it 3 times is very difficult. Only a few ever have won it more than once. Few barely ever even win it at all. Some of the all-time greats never won. Like Corey Crawford never won one. So 3-time Vezina Trophy winner. He retired with a 423, 306, 152 record. So 423 victories, 306 losses, 152 ties. They were ties back then. 76 career shutouts. That's a lot. Over a 16-year career, all of those statistics, 1 year with the Montreal Canadiens, then the next 15 with the Chicago Blackhawks, all of that earned him a spot in the legendary Hockey Hall of Fame.
Yeah, you watch some of those highlights of him, and you got to keep in mind, this is an era of a completely different era of hockey than we know today. We didn't get to sit there and watch Tony O or any of those great players during that era, but the game of hockey was completely different. And for him to put up these numbers and be so successful in that era as a goalie, I mean, you saw the pads he was wearing. You saw the size of him compared to the net, opposed to what Corey Crawford or Marc-Andre Fleury looks like in this era of hockey. And it's just remarkable. Like, goals were scored in bunches back then. And the fact that this guy had 15 shutouts in his rookie year, it's truly remarkable. And, you know, gave him that name as a legendary goaltender. So it's a sad weekend, a sad week in Blackhawks history. They truly lost a legend. But with that being said, it was in an era way before our time, and we know who he is. So it's always great to see players after they retire stick around with the organization. You know, he had one last skate, I think they did a few years back. And Tony O is always still, he's still been involved with the Chicago Blackhawks, which is great to see from a legendary player who retired. And it's good to see their face stick around. It makes, you know, them passing that much more heartbreaking for us.
Yeah. Like you said, he was just so popular in the community. I know Jonathan Taves, Patrick Kane, and Duncan Keith have kind of changed the landscape of like the Mount Rushmore of all time great Blackhawks. And, you know, the top 10 list of before they came around, I would say Phil was pretty locked into the Mount Rushmore of Blackhawks hockey. Like you think about him, you think of guys like Bobby Hall, Stan Mikita, Dennis Savard before him. I know a little later, but I mean, Chris Chelios, I just think of all these great all-time Blackhawks, and now you insert Patrick Kane, Duncan Keith. Tony O is right there.
Oh, by far. I would probably say he, you know, comparing era to era, he's probably the best goaltender to ever play for the Chicago Blackhawks. He was.
Yeah, I think there's a strong argument to be made for Corey Crawford.
Yes, it's comparing era to era, and goaltender is the biggest position you have to do that with.
Yeah, I mean, you saw the clips. He was wearing a Freddy Krueger mask and pads the size of newspapers, as we like to say. So it was just completely different, but our heart goes out to him and his family and all those that were close to him, the Blackhawks organization. You're especially close to that family based on your Bruins fandom as well, I would like to think.
Yeah, his brother Phil Esposito, another hockey legend. You know, he's one of the best Bruins to ever play the game. So, I mean, yeah, it's just a sad day. And that does especially, like, make me, you know, sympathetic for the entire Esposito family and what they're going through right now, because, you know, they spawned two hockey legends, and I mean that, like, they're legendary players to the game, so.
Yeah, and playing for two classic franchises, too, in the Boston Bruins. Didn't Phil end up playing for the Blackhawks for a quick spell, too?
I believe he did toward the end of his career. I don't know if they were ever teammates. That's something I would have to, like, look up. But I want to say that Phil did have a little short stint in Chicago.
Yeah, unless I'm thinking of Bobby Orr.
Well, I know Bobby Orr played like half a year as well.
Yeah, when his knee was broken. But I mean, he seemed like a goofy dude too. Like he was always like doing something funny. Like you remember the Binnie's commercial where he was like doing the line, the conveyor belt, and like blocking things from making its way through. Like I always thought that was really funny.
Well, yeah, there's your answer here. We got Phil Esposito and Tony Esposito doing their one more shift with the Chicago Blackhawks, which is always so cool. That's one thing I love when the Hawks do. They give these players, you know, one more shift, and they go out and honor them. So, yeah, there's Phil and Tony going out together.
So, yeah, we've been to a couple of those, too.
What, the one more shifts?
Yeah, I've seen a couple of them.
Who?
I can't remember. I want to say it was Brian Bickle.
Because that's who I was going to suggest, but I don't know if I was there. You might have been there. I don't know if I was.
I've been there for two. Eddie O, I want to say I was there for.
Really?
Yeah. I've been to more than one, and I'm drawing a blank on who. I would have to go back and look at my old pictures, but I've definitely been to a couple one more shifts in my life.
Yeah. I mean, that would have been cool to go to that one with, you know, two Hall of Famers and Phil and Tony.
Yeah.
But like you said, from what I've seen, and again, Nick, this is way beyond our time of watching. All we have is highlights. But even as an older man, like, he stuck with the organization. He was always showing up doing events, and he just seemed like a great guy. Like, funny, good mood, brought an energy to the room. So,
I mean, yeah, I'd like to have some of the older people in my life or your life give me a couple stories on Tony Esposito, because obviously we weren't around to watch him play. I did not know he played for Montreal at any point. I would have guessed he was he basically was a Blackhawk lifer, but I mean, the couple games that he had with Montreal and the way the draft worked back then, apparently I did some research, the Blackhawks drafted him away from Montreal. So I don't know if that was the league's way of taking from the rich to give to the poor, because that was like kind of weird. Like imagine now guys just drafting players from other teams unless it was expand. No, it couldn't have been expansion because that was way before Tony Esposito's time.
Yeah, that's. I didn't even know that that was a thing. That's crazy.
Another nugget. They were the worst team in the league the year before. They got Tony, and then they got Tony and went on like a run. Like they became one of the better teams in the league again. So.
Yeah, I mean, we have it on the screen here. In 1967, Bruins sent goalie Jack Norris, defenseman Gilles Marat, and forward Pitt Martin to Chicago for Phil Esposito, Ken Hodge, and Fred Stanfield.
I've only heard of two of those names, Pitt Martin and Phil Esposito. I did an article a long time ago that led to me doing some Pitt Martin research.
So Phil was with the Hawks before the Bruins.
Guys, I'm going to come in here and give you a little history lesson.
Here we go.
Here we go. Aldo Gandia with a Blackhawks history lesson live on screen. Let's go.
All right. Phil Esposito was a member of the Chicago Blackhawks, and he was a promising big-time slot center. And he was packaged along with Kenny Hodge and Fred Stanfield, three guys who went on to have fantastic careers with the Boston Bruins and were a part of that formula, along with, of course, Gary Cheevers, the goaltender of the Bruins, and the one, perhaps the greatest hockey player of all time, Bobby Orr. Those guys right there mentioned, and a couple of others, Derek Sanderson, a couple others, really formed that dominant Boston Bruins team. The Blackhawks, in return, got an old, aging goaltender in Jack Norris. Gilles Marat, the defenseman, was a serviceable defenseman, but nothing big. And Pitt Martin had a solid career as a centerman for the Chicago Blackhawks, but nothing compared to what Phil Esposito did. Phil Esposito scoring 76 goals in one season and shattering the goals mark per season that was held by Bobby Hull at the time. And in addition to that, the trade was made even worse once Tony Esposito was acquired from the Montreal Canadiens in a deal in 1968-69. It was so heart-shattering knowing that Tony Esposito was being stopped from winning Stanley Cups because his brother was so damn good with the Boston Bruins. It was a crying shame. And growing up as a kid, Tony O was my favorite player with the Blackhawks because he was left-handed. I'm left-handed. He had that incredible style that nobody had really seen before, that butterfly stance with the legs out this way. And he just played so well. And he was just such a cool guy. You know, there were a bunch of Blackhawks back then who had, you know, problems, like Bobby Hull used to beat the shit out of his wife and stuff. And it was hard to root for guys like that. But Tony O, he was just the best guy. Like you guys mentioned earlier, by all accounts, there was just never a blemish in his career outside the rink, inside the rink. He was just a fabulous guy. But that trade there, it has to be one of the worst trades in NHL history. I would put it in probably the top 25 list, and you might even find it in some top 10 list. But that's my little story on Tony and Phil. They're great, great, great players. They should have played together, but they never did.
I love that story. You got me all sorts of fired up coming in here and just dropping all this hockey knowledge on us. You're part of the show now.
Anytime you need a history lesson from those 60s and 70s Blackhawks teams, I'm here for you. But I might end up crying during some of that because it was a very hurtful time to be a Hawks fan because they were so close so many times and they were either thwarted by the Montreal Canadiens or the Boston Bruins. But those were great, great times to be a hockey fan. You guys would have loved it. They used to be on a nationally televised game on Saturday mornings on NBC. And my brother and I would just love it anytime the Bruins are on because you knew there was going to be a Donnybrook. We learned what the word Donnybrook meant watching the Boston Bruins. They were fighting they would drop the puck. And a second later, there was a fight on the ice with guys like Derek Sanderson and tough guys like Kenny Hodge and stuff. It was great, great, great hockey back then. And it is now, too. A part of the charm of this show is that it's rekindled the love of hockey, because I see the passion that you guys bring to hockey on this show, and it makes me feel young again, remembering those days from the late 60s and 70s and 80s when I was a die-hard Blackhawks fan.
I love it. I love it. And I could see the smirk on Joey's face though, knowing that the Blackhawks made the Bruins really good for a couple years there. He'd love to see that.
Well, yeah, of course. And, you know, a question we get all the time, you know, if you were able to grow up in any era, my answer was always the 70s for many reasons. I like the freedom. And then when you look at the sports, you know, me being a Boston Bruins fan, I know a lot about the history. I had no idea the Chicago Blackhawks and Boston Bruins were that linked to the Bruins' success in the 70s.
Yes.
Like, I know what kind of player Bobby Orr was. You mentioned Derek Sanderson. I knew Phil Esposito, you know, was a dominating horse in the NHL back then. Mm-hmm. I had no idea he came from Chicago in such an impactful trade like that. That's awesome.
Yeah, it was a great time, and I totally agree with you. The 1970s in sports were great. Maybe not so much the NBA. We were just coming off a dynasty of the Boston Celtics, and there were problems in the league and so forth. It wasn't until Magic and Larry Bird joined the NBA, I think late in the 70s and earlys, that the NBA really took off. But baseball, hockey, and football in the 70s, great time to be a sports fan, guys. Keep up the good work, fellas. I'll go backstage.
Oh, I'm sure. That was a great history lesson, everybody. Aldo, I wasn't expecting that, and I loved every second of it.
I know, right? Isn't it going to be cool, like, 50, 40 years from now in 2060, 2050? Like, maybe we'll be able to, you know, talk about the moves that happened today that future generations won't be able to, like, remember or live through, that we'll have the knowledge on that. So thank you, Aldo, for coming in, because he lived it, he saw it firsthand, and that's kind of what sparked his love for hockey. So
yeah, there was this guy called Artemi Panarin,
yeah, you
know, really good back in the day, and the Blackhawks just gave him away for nothing. Brandon Saad, he was a good player, but Artemi Panarin was a great player.
Yeah. And then, especially if Artemi Panarin goes on, you know, win cups and stuff. Like,
I thought you were going to say dies.
No. I mean, eventually he will. But, I mean, he's like our age, so I hope not. I hope we don't.
He's younger than us. I think he's actually about my age.
I think he's your age, Artemi Panarin.
Yeah. So that was great stuff. Tony Esposito, we're going to miss you as hockey fans. It'll be different knowing just – going to that stadium, knowing that he's gone, looking up in the rafters, seeing number 35 retired. Thoughts to him and his family.
Yeah. And the, you know, the tribute, we know we're going to have to, you know, probably sit there and ball our eyes out for a very good tribute that the Chicago Blackhawks are going to put on for their home opener. Cause you know, losing a legend to the game like that is nothing that's going to just brush over come season start. They're going to, you know, remind everyone of the great life of Tony O. So
didn't Stan Mikita pass away in like August too, I want to say, and then they wore 21 on the sweaters for the entire season.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there'll be something on the ice behind the goal net, maybe even in the goal. Cause he was,
oh yeah. I would not be surprised one bit if on the helmet or something, they have the 35 patch or something. Like,
yeah,
it's what teams do. When Milt Schmidt passed away for the Bruins, they wore the 15 on their sweater the entire rest of the season. So
yeah, that's the only sad part about the original six teams. A lot of them have players that, you know,
are pioneers to the game, literally, yeah. Pioneers.
Absolutely. You don't see it as much with teams like the Devils or, you know, the Wild, anything like that. Like, so it's definitely interesting to me because, like you said, where would Blackhawks goaltending be if Tony O was never there, with a history of it, all of it?
Yeah.
So, Tony O, rest in peace. We'll miss you. And for that, we would like to send it to period number two. You like Marvel?
I do.
What's your favorite part about Marvel?
My favorite character, and I'll give you my favorite character, is Captain America. Always has been, always will be.
You like being defiant? Not, yeah, listening to order?
I like, you know, believing in myself.
No,
Okay. What I believe is right.
Yeah.
Shout out. If you haven't seen any of the Marvel movies, what are you doing?
Yeah, I mean, what are the 50 highest grossing movies of all time? Like 20 of them are Marvel movies.
Yeah, and this, the longer you wait, there's a lot of people who say, like, oh, there's so many of them. There's like 20-something movies. If you wait enough
until they're before there's 50.
Exactly. It's never going to stop.
You're just going to keep missing out for the rest of your life just because you've refused to buckle in and just knock them out one time in your life. Then going forward, you'll just have whatever's in the theaters at the time. Yeah. Or in this case, Disney Plus.
No, but my favorite part about Marvel is you get all these amazing stories. And I mean amazing independent stories. And then every few years, they just all come together and the universes collide. You see characters from movies join into one movie. That's my favorite part about it.
And there's things that are relatable in life. Life sucks and it's hard. And there are a lot of things that become difficult throughout. And the way these guys and girls in the movies handle it and, you know, go about their business, it's inspiring. It really is. It's almost like it's relatable, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I see
like,
that.
The way Tony Stark like would do anything for his family, even though he's kind of arrogant and funny, all like a lot, like it kind of reminds me of myself.
Yeah, so, you know, Vinnie Parisi's Tony Stark,
playboy model and entrepreneur.
The only thing you and Tony Stark have in common, the only thing you and Tony Stark have in common is that you both have a blue check mark, probably,
and that we're extremely handsome, successful, and believe in ourselves.
And he's Iron Man, and you're.
Oh, am I? I'm the only guy on this show that hasn't missed a show.
What Marvel character am I, real quick?
In terms of what?
I don't know. You're Tony Stark. You get fucking Iron Man. You're gonna. Who am I?
Where you act? Oh, you're like Star Lord. You kind of give me Star Lord vibes. Like,
I would take Star Lord.
You would make a monumental mistake, and then make up for it like 5 years later.
I don't know about that.
The reason we bring this up is they just released a little new TV show that is canon called What If. And What If is a story. It's on Disney Plus, one episode a week coming out going forward every Wednesday. Hey, if this happened, how would have it change the entire scope of things? So we wanted to bring it to hockey. And, you know, what if this happened? What would that do for the rest? I mean, this is a great summer topic, I think, when there's not much going on.
Mm-hmm.
So I got one right off the start. And, you know, there's an article for it up on pucksandpitchforks.com written by yours truly, because I stole this idea from my good pal Nick Villano. I didn't really steal it from him. All sorts of websites all over the world are doing it right now. What if Zach Parise never left the New Jersey Devils? For those who don't know, in 2012, just 2 weeks after losing the Stanley Cup final to the Los Angeles Kings in six games, Zach Parise narrowed his list down to the Chicago Blackhawks, the New Jersey Devils, the Minnesota Wild, and the Pittsburgh Penguins. He ultimately decided to go to the Minnesota Wild, join a up-and-coming team, and the rest, as they say, is history. But in your opinion, what would have happened had he stayed in New Jersey?
They would not have gone on to miss the playoffs for the next 7 years. That's for sure. Or however long it was.
I think 7 out of 8.
Yeah. I don't want to say that fucked them. Cause I mean, it happens though. I mean, it's the name of the game. It happens in sports, you know, players leaving free agency.
But it's rare for your like franchise captain point per game player to just leave like that for nothing. Normally you trade him.
This isn't a slight to Zach Parise or whatever you say, whatever the term is, but he was a great player for the Minnesota Wild. He played more with them than he did the New Jersey Devils now, correct?
Yeah.
I think it might have hurt. Like, yeah, he went home. The Minnesota Wild have had some great teams in the past decade. I think it hurt his career. I think he would have been more productive with the New Jersey Devils. You know, he was coming off of what, a 90-point year in the 2012 year, and
Cup,
that's not easy to do in the NHL. So I think to answer your question, what if he stays in New Jersey? I think he might be looking at more of a Hall of Fame career, and I'm not saying the Devils would have had, you know, more chances at the Stanley Cup, because Minnesota had some great teams in that time, but you know, it would have changed the whole New Jersey franchise where they're at right now. They would not have Nico Hischier. They probably would not have Jack Hughes, because it would have kind of pushed along, you know, their rebuild, and the whole franchise would be different. So,
yeah. So some notes that I had in the article, Ryan Suter might have came to New Jersey. They probably would have got more out of Corey Schneider had they still traded for him. Ilya Kovalchuk may have never left. David Clarkson may have never left. And Lou Lamoriello may have never left. So I agree that they'd be in trouble here in 2021, as in real time, they're actually on the come up now. But had he stayed, I think 2013, the short season, would have been another chance at the cup.
Don't forget,
when they missed the playoffs by like 1 point that year. If Parisi stays, things are way different.
And yeah, and don't forget, when he left, they still had a productive Travis Zajac. They still had, you know,
Adam Henrique.
Yeah, what's the other guy?
Patrick Elias.
Z.
Oh, Dinas Zubris.
Dinas Zubris was a kind of a prominent player with a prominent role.
Absolutely. He was like a great third line player. Like,
yeah, and then Marek Zielicki, who was at one point, didn't he become captain for them at one point?
No, Bryce Salvador.
Bryce Salvador was the captain. I don't know. It's honestly crazy. And Marty Brodeur wasn't even done. We went on to see Marty Brodeur continue to play for the New Jersey Devils for like
two more years.
So
yeah,
you know, maybe they do get the cup. Who knows? It definitely, you're right. It kind of fucked up the New Jersey Devils for the next 10 years.
It did. And they just now would be starting to be bad, I think. Maybe the last year or two. I think he did get a little older with the Wild. I think people often forget that. Like when they say, oh, he was better with the Devils. Well, age had a little bit to do with that. He had multiple 30-goal seasons and deep playoff runs with the Wild. They never were able to beat the Blackhawks or the Blues, which was their ultimate downfall, that they were always like the second or third best team in the conference. But, I mean, I don't think he's a Hall of Famer. He's going to come up just short, I would say, in my opinion. Hall of very good. But I was more looking at it from a team point of view. I think the Devils really would have had another two or three shots at making a deep playoff run had he signed with them.
Yeah, I completely agree with that.
And he's the reason there was a lockout in 2013, him and Ryan Suter. Signing the 13-year deal, the Players Association and the league did not agree that that was good for the league. And it ultimately led to the lockout that happened in 2013. The Blackhawks ended up winning the Stanley Cup. So, and speaking of the Blackhawks, another one I have. The year before Marian Hossa signed a big contract with the Chicago Blackhawks, he was coming off a year in 2008 where he was a member of the Pittsburgh Penguins and he lost the Stanley Cup final to the Detroit Red Wings. And then in 2009, he joined the Detroit Red Wings and lost the Stanley Cup final to, yep, you guessed it, the Pittsburgh Penguins. So losing the Stanley Cup 2 years in a row to the other team, then in 2009, he signs to play with the Chicago Blackhawks and goes on to win three straight. So I ask you, what if Marian Hossa stayed with Detroit or Pittsburgh?
Or Pittsburgh.
No, Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh.
If he stays with Pittsburgh in 2008, after 2008?
No, I said the second was Detroit, right?
Yeah, he was with Detroit when they lost in 09.
Yes. What if he stayed with Detroit?
So he still never won a cup at this point?
No.
He would – I still believe he, you know, be a Hall of Fame guy, but I don't think he'd have – I think he would retire one of those guys who never got a Stanley Cup.
We're going to have a debate here. I couldn't disagree more.
You think Detroit would have got it done with Marian Hossa?
Might have got one cup. I don't know about 10. Certainly not 10. Absolutely not 10.
Who?
Maybe 13 or 15, the Hawks.
Oh, the 2010. I thought you meant 10 cups.
I certainly think they wouldn't have three. Maybe one. 13, they were dominant. I think
they could have. 13, what if you take Marian Hossa out of that 13 lineup where they went to Game 7 with Detroit and insert him into that Detroit lineup?
That's what I'm saying. And Detroit was nasty, dude. How can you say they wouldn't have gotten that they wouldn't have a cup with Datsyuk and Zetterberg, and Jimmy Howard was an elite goalie at the time. Nicholas Lidstrom, I think, retired the following year. They had Nicholas Cronwall, remember him? Danny DeKeyser, Darren Helm. That team was so sweet.
Okay, I like where Detroit, this is going.
Detroit was arguably better than the Hawks, but the Hawks were just a little bit younger and more fruitful. And it was so even. It was so even that it took Game 7 overtime, Brent Seabrook, to beat them in 2013. The Hawks didn't have to go through them in 10 because the Sharks got lucky and beat them early in the playoffs. If Marian Hossa stays with Detroit, they get another cup. I could not believe that more.
I like where this is going. Here's what happened. Here's what if. If Hossa stays with Detroit, they lose to Detroit in that 2013 playoffs. Detroit ends up going on to win the Western Conference.
That I know where this is going. You
That Boston Bruins team in 2013 was so fucking good. They would have smoked Detroit, and I would be so happy. There would be no 17 seconds. There would be none of this clown shit. The Boston Bruins, I would have 2013 written right under that 2011. What if that happened?
I'm not going to argue with that because that Bruins team was so sweet and they were very capable of beating the Blackhawks, and a couple lucky deflections really, really won the Hawks the series. They were the better team, of course. Like, they won. All credit to them. But, dude, Detroit in 2010 with Hossa, Datsyuk was probably the second best player in the league behind only Crosby. Maybe Malkin. He was right there.
Yeah.
For those who don't know, Google videos of Pavel Datsyuk. Still think he's the most pure skilled player who ever lived. Not the best player ever. That's Gretzky, McDavid, Crosby, Lemieux, Orr. But in terms of pure hands, Pavel Datsyuk. I still wear his jersey to the gym at least once, or t-shirt to the gym at least once a week. Hossa goes to Detroit, stays in Detroit rather, at least one more cup for them.
I think one more cup for the Bruins. I truthfully believe what I said.
I don't think that's crazy. What about the Lightning in 15? Hossa was huge in 15. For those who don't know, Marian Hossa, you can argue, was the best player on those Stanley Cup teams. Patrick Kane ended up having a better career, but most of Patrick Kane's accolades, these Pavel Datsyuk highlights are just stupid.
Looks like me in my rec league.
Yeah.
Dummying people.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, Marian Hossa was like a mix of Taves and Kane. He had the offense of Kane and the two-way strength of Taves. And he was their best player. I'll say it. He was their best forward early on. Now Patrick Kane is better, you know, 100-point season after 100-point season. But the Patrick Kane that won three cups is very different than the Patrick Kane you know today. He actually got better when the team got worse. So Marian Hossa, he stays with Detroit. Multiple cups end up in their lap, in my opinion.
I don't know about multiple. I think
– what happened to Detroit in 2012 when the Devils lost to the Kings? I think the Ducks beat them. And they could, I don't remember exactly what happened to Detroit in 2012, but there were multiple years where Marian Hossa on that stacked team would have changed everything. So that's my what if. If Marian Hossa stays with Detroit, they get an extra cup. Maybe two.
Yeah.
Datsyuk and Zetterberg won one together. Datsyuk has two total, I want to say.
Does he have one earlier than
I think? I think so.
He could. That's, you know, I was a young child, so before he would have won it, because I know it would have had to been before 02.
Yeah.
So
in the last what if I have to bring to the table, I don't know if you have any. What if the Penguins win the lottery in 2004? For those who don't know, the Washington Capitals won the lottery in 2004. The Penguins were the worst team, and the Capitals won the lottery. Ovechkin goes one to the lottery-winning Capitals, and Evgeny Malkin goes number two to those Pittsburgh Penguins. Following year, there's a lockout that wipes out the whole season. The Pittsburgh Penguins win the lottery that season and select someone you know today as Sidney Crosby. So the Penguins ended up, and I believe in that season, the Capitals ended up drafting Nicholas Backstrom, I want to say. I could be wrong. Either way, the Caps ended up with Ovi. The Penguins ended up with Crosby and Malkin. So I ask you, what if the Penguins won the lottery in 04 and selected Ovechkin and never had Malkin?
I think it would be – I honestly think the same shit kind of would have played out. I'll be honest. I still think the Penguins – I think Ovi would probably have three cups opposed to his one. They're both incredibly talented players. Yes, they're both very different.
Crosby and or Malkin and Ovechkin?
Yeah, they're different.
Yeah. I was just confirming that's who you were talking about.
But I think – I still think Pittsburgh would have got it done just as much, if not more.
I don't. Ovechkin's the better player than Malkin, but barely. He's the greatest goal scorer who ever lived. When Evgeny Malkin was in his prime, he was the second best player in the NHL behind the guy playing one center slot ahead of him, Sidney
Crosby. I disagree. I don't think Malkin.
You used to say Evgeny Malkin was better than Ovechkin.
Malkin was never better than Ovechkin.
He was.
It was always Crosby and Ovechkin.
Mm-mm. I couldn't disagree more.
They're very different.
They are very different. One is an elite goal scorer who I hope he breaks Gretzky's record. I think he's the greatest goal scorer who ever lived. Evgeny Malkin in his prime would score 10 less goals but have 50 more points. And he made others around him better. And working behind Crosby, I think that 1-2 center punch leads them to three cups.
They would have been better.
He won the Conn Smythe Trophy in 2009.
So what?
You can argue he should have won it in 16.
It doesn't matter. Oh,
Crosby was injured for a lot of the time, and Evgeny Malkin somehow got better when Sid wasn't in the lineup. Would Ovechkin have gotten better without Sid in the lineup?
He's fucking Ovechkin. You're acting like he's not. You know, a legend who would have been just as good as Sid.
I'm not saying he's not a legend. I think they contribute to team success differently.
It's been compared, like, who's better, Ovi or Crosby? That's been, like, a common
thing. That, to me, is ridiculous.
It's been a common debate, like, for the past decade.
Yeah, but, I mean...
It's always them two compared. It's always Ovechkin and Crosby. Ovechkin and Crosby.
Well, guys, 5 minutes each for fighting!
Those in a while.
Yeah, because I can't believe you're saying that the Penguins would be worse if they had Ovi on their
team. I'm not even necessarily saying Ovechkin's the worst player. That's a different debate. I think they would have won less games without Malkin. The way they built their team in the middle of the ice, Crosby and Ovechkin probably would have been line mates. That would have taken 100 points off of another line.
That's not necessarily how it just works.
But what if is... Exactly, yeah, what I'm
saying. My answer is they would have been a better team.
All right. That's going to be the first of the three that we disagree on. Because I think if Evgeny Malkin was on the Capitals, he would have been their top line center. And there's really not much of a doubt in my mind that he might even be considered better than what people view him today if he was the guy on a team. The way Pittsburgh had things built, so let's look at their cups, right? In 2009, it was Crosby, Malkin, Jordan Staal. That was the best trio of centers in the NHL. Then let's fast forward all the way to 2016 and 17 when they won back-to-back cups. Crosby, Malkin, Bonino. Unstoppable. And if you have Ovechkin on the wing of the top line instead, I think that changes the entire dynamic of the team. I'm not saying they don't win a cup. I just think saying they win three is very difficult, especially 09. Go back and look up what Evgeny Malkin did in 09 when he won the Conn Smythe Trophy. He was better than Crosby. And there are people in Pittsburgh, I know the common national debate is Crosby, Ovechkin. It's been marketed on television for years. Those two teams will forever be rivals for two reasons. Jágr leaving Pittsburgh to go to Washington and Ovechkin versus Crosby. But there are people in Pittsburgh that think Malkin was more instrumental to two of the three cups. I don't agree. Crosby's the best player I've ever seen. I wasn't around for Wayne. But, I mean, I think it's a fair debate with Malkin in there.
I don't think it would go anyway. I think the Penguins would be way more successful than they are now if they had both Crosby and Ovechkin. And I'm not dissing Malkin. I'm not. He's a future Hall of Famer. But, I mean, you don't know what Ovi would have done playing on the Pittsburgh Penguins. Maybe he doesn't play with Sid. Maybe he drives a line and plays with – maybe he turns some second-line center on Pittsburgh into a Nick Backstrom. Who knows?
Yeah, well, maybe Jordan Staal would probably end up staying with Pittsburgh. That's another thing you got to look at there. That's why these what-ifs are fun, because it literally could have changed everything. Would Nicholas Backstrom be a point-per-game centerman? Would he have developed into the premier passer that we know him as today? Because today, I believe Backstrom could go to any team and have 70 assists. But would that have been the case had he not learned how to pass to a guy like Ovechkin?
I mean, even if Ovechkin plays with Kuznetsov. Even if Ovi plays with Crosby, that's fucked.
I know what you're saying. I agree. I just think the depth could have ended up being a little more scarce than it was, having two premier top five centermen.
Yeah. I mean, you can kind of ask that same what if about a lot of things, like a what if Buffalo wins the lottery in 2015. Is Buffalo looked at as one of the elite teams today? Would they have been able to build around Connor McDavid?
No.
You don't think?
No. Edmonton barely has.
I know. You don't think if any team would have selected McDavid, like McDavid would have a cup by now? This dude is what? Oh,
there are multiple teams that I think would have had a cup by now. Yeah. I think if any team in the 5 to 10 range of the lottery would have won the lottery that year, the Devils included, they probably could be like a cup contender if not already have one. Like, what if Colorado won?
I think Buffalo would be a cup contender right now if they won that lottery.
Yeah, I'm not sure because Jack Eichel's not as good as McDavid, but he's very good.
He is very good.
But they haven't been able to do shit. It's not even like they were close with Eichel. If they were close with Eichel, like a bubble team with Eichel, then I would say McDavid might push it over. They're not even that. They're like the worst team in the league with Eichel. So if they had McDavid, maybe then they'd be a bubble team.
But yeah, but I think they got unlucky. I'll be honest. As much as we shit on Buffalo, I do think they got unlucky. Kyle Poso has sucked. Jeff Skinner has sucked. Like they did get pieces. They actually built a decent team around Jack Eichel. Then he had his injuries. They had a good D at one point. You know, they had Robin Leonard.
Yeah. Well, they didn't take care of Robin Leonard though. Robin Leonard had some issues that needed to be taken care of, and he didn't get them taken care of till he went to the Islanders.
Yeah, I mean that seems to be a theme with Buffalo. I don't know. I think Buffalo would be better. I think Buffalo would be looked at as a much better team if they had McDavid over Eichel.
Yeah, that's a very good what if. I personally think they would have screwed it up just the same, except they'd be a little bit better on paper naturally. But would they have let McDavid get that surgery in 2019, right before COVID? And people were saying if McDavid doesn't do this, he could do something that ruins his career. Maybe Buffalo lets McDavid ruin his career.
I mean, yeah, Buffalo, whoever is running overseeing the medical treatment.
They're not letting Jack Eichel get help.
Yeah.
That's why he wants to be out of there. So, yeah, I'm out on Buffalo. I hate the way they run things because I actually like the team and I like their fans. I love watching the Buffalo Bills, those guys jumping through tables that are lit on fire and stuff. I love every second of it. I want to jump through a table lit on fire. I plan on doing it in Buffalo. The shameful thing is they have the same owners and the Bills just are all of a sudden like a powerhouse in the AFC. A lot of it has to do with the quarterback. You get one of those, things can take off quickly. Bears.
I just thought of a funny what if. Because we're probably not going to do this tomorrow. If you're not aware, every Thursday, 2 p.m. Crosstown Crosstalk. What if it never rains in Cleveland in 2016.
That's an easy one. The Cleveland Indians would absolutely be World Series champions. There is not a single doubt in my mind that they would have won that game.
I just wanted to get you going.
I mean, it's non-debatable to me. I will have anyone.
We don't have our Sox haters and our Cubs lovers in this chat. We'll have them tomorrow. But, I mean, that is a good what if.
You can ask me that again tomorrow. I'll tell you the same thing. And I thought you were going to bring up Eloy. That's where I mean, thought you were going.
There's a lot of things you can say.
What about sports?
The Cubs would have
done. What if Tom Brady stays with New England?
Yeah.
The Bucs would probably go 7-9. And everyone would say, oh, if they only had a good quarterback.
I thought of this one. I don't know if I was going to ask it, but I might as well now because our friend Santiago brought it up. What if the Bruins?
I thought of this too.
What if the Bruins don't trade Tyler Seguin? That is a pivotal moment in, you know, this mid, that whole early to mid, you know, time of the Boston Bruins. That trade, I'm not going to say it necessarily fucked them up for a little bit because they made that trade. They made that trade after the 2013 Cup. It was 4th of July in 2013. I'll never forget the day. I was very sad. I loved Tyler Seguin. He was an up-and-coming superstar. But they got in the defense of the trade. Granted, Tyler Seguin went on to be a great player for Dallas. Kind of fell off a little bit, but I don't think he's fully done. Just wait for him to have a full healthy year. It's been at least 2 years since he's been able to play a full 100% healthy 82-game season. So look for Tyler Seguin next year, and I love him. But they after that trade, they had Louis Erickson. They got Joe Morrow, and they got Louis Erickson, Joe Morrow. Who was the other guy?
Riley Smith,
thank you. Riley Smith went on to play first line right wing with Patrice Bergeron and Brad Marchand and won the 7th player award. He had almost 30 goals, I think, with them. Louis Erickson played with David Krejci for a bit and then eventually formed a line with Carl Soderberg, who you guys know. And just the chemistry with those two Swedish players was amazing. Joe Morrow ended up leaving. But they went on to win the President's Trophy in 2014. They signed Jerome Iginla. They were one of the best teams in the league following that trade. Then it started to diminish. You know, Tyler Seguin's doing stuff in Dallas. Those pieces, Louis Erickson eventually goes away, signs in Vancouver. They trade Riley Smith to Florida for Jimmy Hayes, which terrible, terrible move. We see the player Riley Smith became, you know, going into Rich Peverle was involved, my guy. Matt Fraser, too. Wow. We saw the player Riley Smith became in Vegas being drafted or acquired from Florida. So the trade ended up falling apart in the long run. But right away, that Bruins team was ready to win the Cup in 2014. And I do believe it had to do with, you know, the production of Louis Erickson and Riley Smith on that team. So,
yeah, I pretty much agree with everything you said. It was a bad trade, but it was a short-term trade. And in the short term, it was good. In the long term, it was terrible. So I'm with you on that. I liked the trade for Dallas a lot. Jamie Benn and Tyler Seguin have become one of the league's best duos. Tyler Seguin. They probably wouldn't have McAvoy.
Yeah, that's another thing. They probably wouldn't have David Pastrnak today. Like, so all that, I would do it over again.
Who knows how the Bruins would have done in 2014 – them being a really good team and having a less than ideal first round draft pick led to them getting Pastrnak, who, if today the draft was redone, would probably go second to Draisaitl, maybe third.
Yeah, exactly. Gonzo had a question in the chat, a what if that kind of went over my head. So I apologize, Gonzo, but he wants to know about the concussion issues revolving around Paul
Correa.
Yeah.
Paul Correa, if he never gets concussions, probably goes down as one of the great players ever. I mean, he still is. I believe Anaheim retired his number, didn't they? Number 9?
I'm trying to find that out. I'm trying to pull up his stats here, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's another one of those, you know, what ifs that you can say the same thing about, like, Mario.
Frozen Joey. Love to see it. I believe he was about to say Mario Lemieux. Mario Lemieux went on to have cancer and all that kind of stuff, and it put a nice pause on his career. So I believe Joey was going to go into what if Mario Lemieux never had to leave for a while. And in that case, things would just be completely different. He probably would have gotten close to Gretzky in terms of points. And I don't know if he would ever like broke it or anything like that, but Mario Lemieux was a great player. He's one of the greatest players ever. So to see him have to skip some time like that, I think was an issue. But, you know, it happened. It ended up being where they got Sidney Crosby and all that. So, you know, Joey's computer just decided to take a dump on him while he was about to talk about one of the greatest players ever. How disrespectful of him. I mean, be better than that, Joe. My what if is, what if Joey actually had good internet connection? Then I wouldn't be sitting here talking to myself about hockey with anyone. So if there's anyone in the chat that would like to bring something up, I know Santiago had the Tyler Seguin and Gonzo brought up Paul Kariya. Yeah, Joey's claiming the internet went out for him. Oh, he's back.
It did. I'm not.
I already talked about Paul Kariya or Mario Lemieux on your behalf.
Yeah, you saw that. I honestly have been had these storms. I don't know what the hell's going on. I've had internet troubles all day, and I don't know how it's not affecting you. We're on the same fucking internet, but it's kind of frustrating.
The internet was tired of hearing your complete nonsense for about an hour. So
yeah,
for that,
I still have a frozen, like, usually I have my, you know, my white screen in front of me, and I was actually going to put the White Sox on today because they're playing on YouTube. My TV's been frozen since we started this show, so I don't know what the fuck
makes going me on. So happy, because I have a fully functioning three streams and this show going on at the same time. So maybe I'm just stealing from you, which in every sense of the word would be worth it to me, because I get to watch the White Sox probably end up losing 1-0 to these Twins. So that kind of sucks.
Yeah. What if the Hawks kept Panarin and Teuvo Teravainen?
They would have been a cup contender for at least 2 more years for the duration of Panarin's contract. He probably would have left in free agency the same as he did after Columbus. But I believe they would have been a serious cup threat for 2 more years. And they would be kind of like what we said about the Devils with Parisi, where they were just now start to be getting bad. The Hawks were just now starting to get like be bad. Where yeah. They've been an unwatchable piece of trash for like 3 years now. And that would just be starting now. And we wouldn't be really mad about it because of the success, where the reason we're mad about it is because of mistakes like Teuvo and Panarin.
But in their defense, they would have never been able to keep Panarin after that contract. Don't forget, I believe when they dumped Teuvo to Carolina, they sent Brian Bickle with to get that cap hit off. Yeah.
But we quickly learned that that's a bad philosophy. It's a bad way to run your business. Give up something great to get rid of hefty baggage.
Yeah.
It didn't work with Teuvo Teravainen. It was dumb with Vinny Hinostroza to get rid of Marian Hossa. He went on to have a pretty good season with the Arizona Coyotes. There are lots of mistakes that were made that Jalmerson for Murphy looks good now in 2021 because Jalmerson's retired and Murphy's just now starting to be a really good defenseman. But in 2017, when the trade was made, it was an awful trade because the Hawks were trying to win now and Murphy wasn't ready yet while Jalmerson was.
Yeah.
So the trades they made never really made sense for like their current times. If they were rebuilding, Jalmerson for Murphy would be awesome. But they weren't. They were trying to keep their cup success going, so that's why that trade is terrible.
Yeah.
People like to rip on the Andrew Ladd trade. I loved that for the Blackhawks. It didn't work. They were bounced by the Blues in Game 7 of the first round, but they were trying to win the cup in that season, so they made a trade to win the cup. So that's my thoughts on that.
Yeah. I like that. Nice little what if.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Good stuff. I'll address Gonzo's. What if Martinez didn't screw over Aldo's dreams in 2014? He screwed over a lot of people's dreams. I forgave Martinez in short order. He also scored the Stanley Cup winning goal about 2 weeks later against the New York Rangers, who I never need to see win the cup in my life.
That's what I was thinking of when I saw that. I was thinking because he scored the overtime cup clinching goal against the New York Rangers.
Two series winning goals in a row.
Yeah, and I forgot that he did it against the Hawks because I was wondering why if Aldo had like money invested in the Rangers that year or something.
No, it was probably the Blackhawks for sure.
Yeah.
So let's get into a little bit of NHL news before we head on out of here. Period number three.
I thought you were just going to get right into it and not say period number three.
What do you think? I'm stupid.
I mean,
I am. I work in sports because I couldn't like build engines or anything like that. So
you can't like cure disease. What are you doing?
I don't know how to do anything. I like know this job and that's it.
Yeah, you're right. You can't cook.
I really wouldn't want it any other way. I like when people do things for me while I just talk.
Yeah. No one wants you to change.
Yeah, there are probably some people that want me to change, but I'm not going to. Yegor Sharangovich and Yanni Kuokkanen have signed contract extensions with the New Jersey Devils, and that followed them acquiring Thomas Tatar in a big free agent signing. They still have about $12 million in cap space to play with. I would like to know your thoughts on the New Jersey Devils as they stand.
Yeah, I mean, I call him Tomas Tatar.
Tomas Tatar.
That's actually not a bad little signing for them. When I saw that, I was like, the Devils are rebuilding, but they're going to try to be competitive next year. You know, they got Dougie. I think it's going to be a much better year for Mackenzie Blackwood. I think very highly of him. I think having Dougie is going to take some pressure off of a guy like PK Subban. And then a full season of Nico Hischier and Jack Hughes. I mean, this team's actually going to be pretty competitive. I say it every year. I don't say it every year. I didn't say it last year. But the season going into the cutoff COVID year, you remember me saying that the Devils are going to be good, and I'm starting to feel that way again going into this season. Tomas Tatar helps this team.
Yeah, I'm tampering my expectations a little bit. There's less unknowns, though, this time around. Like, we're not relying on – like, we know Jack Hughes is going to be good now. We didn't know that 2 years ago, the season you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Nikita Gusev was a failure. PK Subban was kind of a failure. Like – Thomas Tatar, proven. You know you're going to get 20 goals and 50 points. Dougie Hamilton could be one of the best defensemen in the league in any given year. Yeah, I like the moves they've made so far. I'm not, like, jumping through a wall excited yet, but I do think they have a chance to be a bubble team at minimum.
Yeah, I agree.
A team that I'll be with. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say I have a little a piece of news that you'd – I don't think you had written down, and you mentioned your Devils, so I figured I'd mention my Boston Bruins. Going into the 2022 Olympics, head coach Bruce Cassidy was named an assistant coach. And when I saw that, I was like very happy. I was very proud because it's about time this guy looks at
Canadian heritage.
What?
Because of your deep Canadian heritage. Deep
Canadian heritage. That's right. No, it's good to see that, Bruce Cassidy's getting recognized as one of the best coaches in the NHL. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, and he's going to, John Cooper. I'm trying to think of who is Joel Quenneville involved?
No, I have it right here. The head coach is John Cooper of the Tampa Bay Lightning, and then the assistant coaches are going to be Bruce Cassidy of the Boston Bruins, Peter DeBoer of the Vegas Golden Knights, and Barry Trotz of the New York Islanders. So talk about a coaching staff. It's very different from the last time we saw this team compete in the Olympics. You know, we had, I believe it was Babcock. Mike Babcock, Joel Quenneville, and Claude Julien were
the old guard.
Yeah, were three of the guys.
Bruce Boudreau.
And Bruce Boudreau. And so it's kind of like a new era of, aside from Barry Trotz, you got some younger coaches in there. And I'm just very proud that Bruce Cassidy is amongst, the assistant coaching staff. And all credit to John Cooper. He earned that head coaching job. So
100%.
I'm excited for the Olympics. We're going to talk plenty about that. Does this kind of tell you that NHL players are going to go?
I think they're going to go. There's a 2-week break in the schedule.
There's a 2-week break in the schedule. It seems like players have mentioned it. And now we see, coaching staffs being picked. Like, there's no way that all those coaches turn down the opportunity. They're going to, if they don't go, I feel like these coaches are going to miss time with their teams, right?
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. So, but I do believe the NHL will participate, and I'm very excited for it.
The only thing is, if they don't go, those guys can go be the coach for the minor league guys or whatever while the other guys are at home on vacation, because there's a 2-week break in the schedule.
Yeah. Oh, so, yeah.
We'll see what happens there. A team the Devils will be fighting with for a playoff spot, Philadelphia Flyers. Carter Hart, $4 million, 3 years. What do you think?
Yeah, it's kind of weird that he ended up getting, I guess you can call this a bridge deal, right?
Yeah, he wasn't that good last season.
He wasn't that good, and that kind of fucked him out of getting an 8-year big goalie deal, because this kid, you know, you and I think really highly of him, and of course our buddy Dylan as well. He's a big Flyers fan. Carter Hart, I truthfully believe, you know, didn't we play each other in a playoff series, Philly, or in the bubble?
Who?
Carter Hart versus Carey Price. Didn't that happen? Did that ever happen? I don't know. I feel like it was a story. Carter Hart playing against Carey Price.
Maybe they did. Philly had a bye last in the bubble.
Did they?
And Montreal beat Pittsburgh. So, yeah, that actually does sound right.
Yeah, and anyway, you know, that's kind of what you compare Carter Hart to. Comparing him to Carey Price, who's the best goalie of our era, Carter Hart's going to be an NHL superstar, and I think this is good for the Philadelphia Flyers.
Carter Hart and Mackenzie Blackwood could be Team Canada guys.
Yeah.
And I know Doug Armstrong is the GM of Canada, so he might just pick his guy Jordan Binnington, even though he doesn't even slightly deserve it. Like, we'll see what happens there. But Carter Hart's a very good goalie. Don't let last year fool you.
And, well, Carey Price is the number one.
I would say so. I would think Marc-Andre Fleury could get a nod, too.
Yeah. Don't forget. Yeah.
Carter Hart and Mackenzie Blackwood might have to wait for the following Olympics once the old guard is truly gone. But yeah, they're the upcoming Team Canada guys for me. Got nothing?
I agree. Carter Hart. I think very highly of Carter Hart. We talked about this last time. I'm like almost positive they played each other. I'll have to look it up. But we looked at Carter Hart, you know, different than other goalies. Kind of similar to the way I look at Spencer Knight. I think those are your two guys, respectively, for their countries. Spencer Knight's the future of America goaltending, and Carter Hart's the future of the Canadian goaltender.
Yeah, that's very fair. Detroit and Jacob Vrana, 3 years, 5.2, kind of a lot of money. But yeah. Vrana's a very good player.
Didn't they acquire him at the deadline from Washington?
Correct.
In exchange for...
Anything Steve Yzerman does is smart, in my opinion.
Yeah, who did
Washington have back-to-back cups because of him?
I'm drawing a blank on who Washington got.
Say that again?
I'm drawing a blank on who Washington got.
I know Panic was involved.
But, yeah, that's
Anthony Mantha.
Yep, you're right.
Yeah.
But that's very good for Detroit. I still think they're going to be, you know, mediocre hockey team, but good for Vrana. That is a lot of money, and I think he deserves it.
Yeah, so he deserves it. I think it's great for Detroit, and I don't think they're going to be bad for much longer. One or two more years at maximum, they're going to turn it around and be a thorn in our side really soon.
Yeah.
Didn't Mike Hranica say that last week?
About Detroit?
Yeah. He's, like, very high on Detroit and, like, what they can do over the next couple of years.
Maybe he said that.
Yep. So you might remember Ross Colton. He is the Stanley Cup hero. He signed a pretty nice extension. $1 million for the first year, $1.25 million for the second year, 2 years, Tampa Bay Lightning. They're championship winning goal scorer will stay around. What do you think?
I mean, yeah, it's a great depth piece. 2 years, you said at $1 million?
$1 million for the first year, 1.25 for the second.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, I mean, that's a great bottom six signing right there. You know they're going to need that because You know, they're without Tyler Johnson now. I believe they still have a couple moves to make because they're still over the cap, right?
Yeah, and there's no more Blake Coleman. He went to Calgary. Goodrow is with
New England. Goodrow's gone.
Yeah.
Who another guy was great.
Yeah, they're awesome at when these guys go get paid somewhere else, bringing in new guys. And then those guys will go get paid someone else, and they'll bring in new guys. Like, it's the lightning way these days, it seems like.
Yeah, like remember when Nikita Kucherov started off as like a third line guy? It was Palat, Tyler Johnson, and Kucherov. It was like the triplets was like a young line who no one knew about. And then all of a sudden, here's Nikita Kucherov, one of the best right wingers in the entire league.
Yeah, and Johnson and Palat were like offensive studs. But then when Kucherov like really rose to the top and the emergence of Braden Point, and we all know about Steven Stamkos. That's when they were like, all right, Johnson and Palat, you guys are defensive forwards now, who we only need about 50 points from. And they were like, all right, bet. It's the Lightning. It's how they win cups. One conversation I wanted to have involving some NHL news. Darnell Nurse signed a pretty hefty contract with the Edmonton Oilers. They gave him 8 years at $9.25 million. And they have McDavid making 12 and Draisaitl also making 8, which kind of looks like a nice contract now. But it just doesn't seem like they do much negotiating. It's like, all right, take whatever you want.
This when I saw this, I was genuinely like shocked. Like, and Darnell Nurse, this was his best season by far. He was awesome for them.
He's a great player.
He was. Did that really bring Edmonton anywhere? No, not really. It brought them to getting swept by the Winnipeg Jets. But there was a lot of reasons that went into that. $9.25 million for a guy who's coming off of his first, like, okay, that was a really fucking good year. That's crazy. Especially when, like you said, you have Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl probably taking up 20% of their cap. So I don't know about that move.
It just doesn't seem like they negotiate at all. Yeah. Like, they give everyone the max of what they're worth no matter what. Like, no one takes pay cuts over there. No one – it doesn't seem like anyone – the main focus is winning the cup. Like, look at Tampa. He's making – Darnell Nurse is making the same amount as Kucherov and more than Stamkos.
I just hope Charlie McAvoy had his phone off when that happened and didn't see that. There's no way that I see the Bruins giving Charlie McAvoy – north of 9.5 mil, and that's what Seth Jones got, and that's what Darnell Nurse is getting.
Dougie Hamilton,
and I think Charlie McAvoy is better than all three of those guys, but I don't see him making more than 7 mil.
Yeah, Charlie McAvoy is the most interesting contract of all time because he plays for a team that doesn't really ever overpay guys, especially their homegrown ones, and he deserves 10 mil if that's what these other guys are making.
Yeah, and it just seems like lately, like, it's the theme of young defensemen just signing long-term for a shit ton of money, and of course it's happening right before Charlie McAvoy's looking to sign his ticket, so.
The Bruins might do it.
I don't know. We'll see.
You're going to get as lucky with them as you did with Pastrnak or Marchand or, you know.
Pasta went deep. Pasta missed all of training camp, and he went into, like, a deep arbitration.
I know.
And he ended up signing for 6.7. Or no. Did he get 7?
He didn't have the years that he's having now. There's no way he would make that little now. McAvoy has like top 5 Norris Trophy seasons under his belt now.
Yeah.
So that's going to be interesting.
Real quick, while we're talking about the Bruins, I did see that.
Yeah, because they don't come up often.
Yeah. I did see that because after this upcoming season, Patrice Bergeron's contract's over. What do you think with an aging guy like that? I think he's, what, 35, 36? What do you think an aging a guy like that kind of contract he gets? The Bruins have already told him he gets to pick his term. It seems like a very open, like, for Patrice Bergeron, he kind of has a lot of leverage here. Rightfully so. He's the captain, and I don't think he's going anywhere by any marks. But what do you think he makes, and how long do you think he chooses? Because I do believe that no matter what term he says, if he says, Don, I want to sign a 5-year deal, they're going to give it to him.
When is he done?
After this season.
So he's currently on an expiring contract.
Yeah.
I would say 5 mil. max.
It would be a pay cut, but
what did Chara get in his last contract with the Bruins?
I want to say like 2.
Okay, but he was 42.
Yeah, I want to say it was like 2 mil.
I would like to know what Chara's contract looked like when he was 36. Even. Probably yeah, still making 7-8 mil, right?
I want to say he signed like 3 1-year deals with the Bruins in a row. They just kept doing it. And then finally this past year that they were like, you know, it's time for us to move on. And it was all the Bruins side that didn't sign Zdeno. And it took him right before the end or right before the season for him to sign with Washington. And I think it's going to be something similar. I do believe he's going to play in the NHL next year.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what happens with him. I think he would have retired by now, probably, had he thought about going that route. But I got a nice little thing on Seattle. They did sign Aiden Hill to be their third goalie, I want to say. Vince Dunn, 2 years, 4 mil. Marcus Johansson, 1 year, 1.5 mil. Seattle's looking a little deep.
Yeah. I'm excited. Like, deep is the exact word. They, you know, I said after the Jaden Schwartz signing and the obviously Philip Grubauer signing, but Johansson extending Dunn, I honestly believe that Seattle is gonna be better than a bubble team. And if you're not on board with that, like,
no, I am. I take a look at the division now. Vegas is the top dog. Edmonton has McDavid. Huh?
Plus 5,000 now. It's dropped a lot. Yeah.
I got him at plus 75,000.
7,500?
Whatever. They don't really have, like, a superstar forward.
No. But what if Jordan Eberle, like, Jordan Eberle was, you know, he looked really good in the playoffs.
Yeah, he needs to be like Riley Smith or Marchessault, like that type of production. They'll probably have a guy who comes through and plays well like Wild Bill, maybe not 40 goals, but a guy we don't know who it's going to be yet. They got the goalie. Philip Grubauer is really good, and Drieger's really good too. He's probably better than any backup Vegas used. Their defense is pretty good. I like Dunn. But I just look at the division. Like I said, Vegas. I would say Edmonton just because they have McDavid and Draisaitl and Nurse, who's a good player. That should be enough to at least make them like a playoff team in their own bad division. I'm not high on the California teams going into this season. The Kings could prove me wrong. The Sharks will probably be without Evander Kane. Everyone knows about that whole thing. The Flames are hit or miss. They could be good. They could be a bubble team. That's really all I got on Seattle. It's been a Seattle-heavy summer on this show. This could be bar down Kraken talk. Based on the way the summer's gone.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's the first summer with them. So I can't wait to get a jersey.
I would like to get one too. I would probably get Matt Beniers.
You haven't even worn the hat. Where's that hat? Is that it behind you? No, that's your Yankees hat.
Right there.
Oh, well, I haven't even seen you wear it. You know, you won that hat. You earned that hat. You should be wearing it right now.
I'll wear it on this show. Next week, I'll wear it the entire show.
I put my hat on. I really shit the bed on wearing this one. I saw this hat on Twitter, I think, yesterday because Fabian Lysell signed his entry-level deal. It's the first-round pick of the Boston Bruins.
Yeah.
So.
Adam Pellick, 8 years, 5.75 with the Isles. It's a good contract. 8 years, he's just a solid defenseman, 5 mil. He's so sweet. He almost single-handedly beat the Bruins.
I think that is an amazing, amazing deal. How Lou was able to get that done. We're talking, I think he'd be worth like 7 mil. From what he proved to me on the New York Islanders, especially in the playoffs, him and Ryan Pollock?
Pollock.
No, or, yeah.
Pollock. This is Pollock.
Ryan Pollock and Adam Pellick, those two fucking guys, like, that is a good defensive tandem. And I don't even know if they always play with each other, but
they got some matches to pair up there.
That's very good for the New York Islanders, who just always seem to be successful nowadays.
Absolutely. And then a couple more to touch on. Zach Aston reached 1 year, 1.725 with the Pittsburgh Penguins. It's another depth signing for them. He's been a really good player. And then Dante Fabro, 2 years, 4.8 with the Nashville Predators. Good players. Yes.
Yeah, and Zach Aston-Reese, you know, I think he's got a newfound role without I think both Jared McCann and Brandon Tanev are now, you know, no longer on Pittsburgh, and they're joining Seattle. So those are – I think those are great depth players for Seattle, but there's some –
McCann's on the Leafs.
Huh?
I think McCann's on the Leafs.
Oh, he didn't go to – I thought he went to Seattle too.
I think they traded him to the Leafs. Unless
maybe.
That might be who they selected from the Leafs. I would have to go back.
Regardless, they're not with Pittsburgh anymore. So this signing for Zach Aston-Reese is he's got some big shoes to fill.
Yeah, he's gonna get an opportunity to prove himself for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I see some football chat going on here, talking about Alex Smith being at Bears camp. That's really exciting to me. I love that because he helped Mahomes and all that. You know. He probably wants to become a coach. He's a very well – got a big brain, I would say, coaching ability in his future. Lots of stuff going on across the Bar Network, too. All the Bear shows are popping. I'm going to try and connect with my guy, Laro. I know you're watching, and if you're not, I'm mad at you. I want to write an article on the Bulls. I already have the shell for it done, and I need some insight on why they can be a playoff team. And then, of course, the Bears, fantasy football, Justin Fields. Nobody can protect him on the Bears line because they're all either have mystery injuries or COVID. So that kind of sucks.
You got something on your computer that you're, like, shuffling on your computer that we're hearing the mic? Huh. Moving anything around? And we got to get some mics because I don't know. I'm hearing a little bit of feedback. But, yeah. Well,
someone said I froze in the chat, so. Maybe that had something to do with it.
You're fine for me. This weather has made I wasn't kidding about this whole connection issues. Like,
yeah, I know. I know sometimes I do fiddle with things on my desk. It's just my habit. Maybe. I don't know. I wasn't touching anything that time, though.
But, yeah, the first Bears game is Saturday, right?
Yes, against the Miami Dolphins, who they had a joint practice with today, so that's fun. We're going to see Tua Tagovailoa. We will see Justin Fields. Andy Dalton will probably throw an interception or two. I don't know if he'll play, but I'm very much looking forward to it. I can't wait to watch it. We will be in Wrigleyville watching the game at some of those bars. If you happen to catch us on the streets, make sure you say hello. We will be at Guaranteed Rate Field watching the Chicago White Sox play the New York Yankees on Saturday and Sunday. We'll be at that complete dump Wrigley Field watching Green Day, Weezer, and Fall Out Boy on Sunday night. Pretty forward.
And that's all after we have tomorrow, 2 p.m. on Crosstown Crosstalk. We're going to be previewing the first ever MLB game played in the state of Iowa that I'm looking forward to. We got the New York Yankees versus our Chicago White Sox playing in the Field of Dreams game. I haven't been this excited for a baseball game that's not like a playoff game. I don't think ever, because like it's not like you have a winter classic or anything or any of those cool things that some other sports do. This is going to be fucking sick for MLB.
I literally cannot wait. We're watching the movie tonight, and you know I'm going to have a nice refresher for it going into the podcast. I believe you will too. I just decided for you. You're watching it with me.
Planned on it. So yeah.
We also have a big interview with Cubs prospect Cole Franklin. That'll be on the show tomorrow. I'm very much looking forward to that. Trying to inject some life into that dead fan base they got going on right now. They're all sad because they traded away all their favorite players, and I'm just so devastated about it. So being the nice White Sox fan that I am, I'm going to bring some prospects and things to look forward to for Cubs fans. What do you think about that?
I mean, that's the ultimate spin zone.
Aren't I a big person for it?
Yeah. Great. How was your past weekend taking your visits to Wrigley Field?
I hate that place. I'll get into it more tomorrow, but it's not fun. The food is crap. It's hard to get in and out of. There's nowhere to go. It's just – yeah.
So tune in tomorrow, 2 p.m., like I said, Crosstown Crosstalk, where Vinny goes more into his opinion on the great Wrigley Field.
Yeah, can't wait to talk about Wrigley Field and the actual home team winning the game 4-0. That was awesome. Make sure you tune in Crosstown Crosstalk, 2 p.m. In all seriousness, I'm very excited to bring this interview with Cole Franklin to you all. Next week, we got a big interview, a bigger Cubs-related interview even. And I'm very excited for that. I'm not going to say it just in case. But, you know, the next 2 weeks of Crosstown Crosstalk are going to be very me gloat about the White Sox while also make Cub fans excited for the future heavy. So, yeah. The dreams. Yeah. Can't wait.
And any last on hockey? Of course we take sports serious. A little too seriously.
Yeah, follow me on Twitter at Vinny Parisi and you'll see just what he means by that.
Yeah.
Anything left on hockey before we head on out?
No, it's been a good week. Actually, a decent amount happened this past week, so gave us plenty to talk about. We'll see as the dog days of the off season continue. But
yeah, I'm not sure next week we'll be able to have a whole period where we have stuff to talk about of news from the previous week.
Yeah,
I'll be stunned if that's the case. So, but we're gonna have lots of fun hockey conversation over the summer. There doesn't have to be actual. We could talk about what ifs. And maybe make a couple Mount Rushmores or top five lists. I'll scream at you about why Malkin was better than Ovechkin in his prime. Maybe we could talk about the future Blackhawks captain at some point. There are a lot of things to discuss that aren't directly related to any current happenings. So I hope people continue to tune in throughout the summer. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Yep.
And for at Joey Parisi on Twitter and at Vinny Parisi on Twitter, thank you for listening. Thank you.